All right, so we're just here kicking about in the studio with modular for the moment, but we're gonna try and transform this into something else by getting it into another sampler so we can get really hands-on. It's gonna be kind of a long video, more longer than usual. Before we get started, I wanna let you know about episode 30 of the Samplers podcast, which is live. So I just wanted to put it out there so you guys can check that out after you watch this video. It is an intriguing subject covering the technical nature of gear, which means turning knobs, tweaking, and all the things we do, versus the intuitive nature of music, which means the human aspect, the part that comes from within you, for those of you who believe in that sort of thing. That's one thing. Second is to remind you all about the ASR-10 Ensoniq Beginners Manual, which is currently available. You know where to get it, and you know what it is. So now that that's out of the way, let's kind of deal with the things that we're going to be dealing with today. I'm here with the modular synth here, and I'm going to start with the source material, and this is going to provide the source material for me, and I'm going to, well, let's just take a listen. Super huge wave. Starting with that wave as our source material. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that and transfer it to the Akai S950 in order to get more character. So this, shout out to B-Boy Tech Report Corey Banks. He has a concept of using synthesizers as sampling records. So he views all his synths as vinyl, which I think is completely genius. And that's what we're kind of doing today. So this is the vinyl for today, and I'm sampling this, right? And I'm going to take that, transfer to a sampler where I ultimately have more control. Yes, there's tons of control here, but in a sampler, once you lock a waveform in and it becomes a sample, you just are able to treat things differently. And that's what I'm hoping to do today. So anyway, let's head over to the S950 and see where we can get from there. So in case you're wondering, the patch is very, very simple. There's one pulse wave here coupled with a saw wave, and the two of them just make for a really heavy, heavy synth tone that you've heard right there. So I'm sampling it raw without any filters or anything, just completely untamed, and we'll see where we get from there. All right, so we got stuff into the Akai S950, and I didn't do much. Just took advantage of the filter that we have here in the S950, which is analog, and it has like a little kind of weird resonant thing going on to it. So it's the classic S950 sound, like you know it when you hear it. But anyway, this is what we got. Right? And I'm not done, because that's just a little bit just standard for me. I'm going to take it and put it into another sampler. And, well, we'll see what that is. So we have everything now into this person, which is the Ensoniq EPS Classic, a 13-bit sampler, which just makes everything sound a little bit more harsher than it really is, no matter what you do. But in this case, I scaled down the sample rate on the input to 17 kilohertz, which gave it a really rough sound. So I'll walk through what I've done, and then we'll take a listen to what we got. So first, I put the original sample here on track 5, just unaltered with a lowered sample rate, which does sound pretty rough. Then in order to experiment, so I always have something to go back to just in case I don't like what I did, I copied the sample along with everything, basically duplicated it to track number 6, which gives me a fresh place to do whatever I want without any fear of making a mistake that I can't go back and fix. So once I copied it, I went into the edit wave feature and set it to, let's see if I can get here. Where am I? Set it to loop bidirectionally. So it'll go forward and then go backward. And then I set the loop ridiculously small. So I have the actual start of the sample starting at the same time that I have the loop, well, just a little bit further on, which is really small. The loop start is starting like just after that. Then I have the loop end pretty much like literally samples after that. So it's really, really tight. And the loop position is somewhere in that, right? So then what we can do here is I've set on the Classic, you can have either the loop modulated, which means changed. I can have the start time modulated, or I can have both. And you guys probably can't see that. Doesn't matter. Anyway, and I've modulated that by the LFO at a small range. So what will happen is the sample will loop really, really fast, but it will still travel through the entire length of the sample very, very slowly. So you will hear it change and kind of just do kind of weird glitch effects as it goes through that. So in order to pull that off, we'll go into edit LFO. We need to set the LFO speed to a really, really slow speed, which I set it pretty much next to nothing. So it will slowly and as gently as possible go through the sample in these little small looping increments. And we get a real kind of transformation of the sound by doing that, and completely transforms it to something else. So now that I've explained that, let's take a listen to what we've done. Okay, so now we're at a place where we can play the Ensoniq Classic with this MIDI keyboard. And the sample that we spoke about that ended up getting resampled into the Classic sounds like this. You see, super ridiculously nasty. That's kind of like the EPS Classic's thing. Like, it will just put some serious fuzz and grit on anything that you put in there, granted that you treat it properly. Like, you can get a clean transfer if you sample at high sample rates, but anytime you start dipping the sample rate a little bit lower, it gets really harsh, and it will definitely put some clothes on whatever sample you put in there. And those clothes will most likely end up being winter clothes. It just puts some really nice abrasive fuzz on whatever you do. So now that we've done that, the second process that I was talking about sounds like this. I forgot to mention that I did add some filter modulation that's controlled by envelope. So again, as the sample plays, you're going to hear a bit of changes within the filter as well. I also have it modulated additionally with the mod wheel here. So there's two things with the filter going on here, and we'll just go through both as the sample goes. But first, let's just hear what it sounds like in its complete form. Right, so you heard some changes there, and that's kind of what we ended up doing. So now that I have that, let's just listen to it with the filter changes as well that I've made. Right, so we have some variation there, and it's kind of neat. So you can tailor these samples any way you want, and I'm just kind of messing about now. And if I wanted to, I can take this patch here and recapture it into something else, like the Ensoniq ASR-10. I'm debating on whether I should do that. You know what? Let's go ahead and do it. So we're here at the Ensoniq ASR-10. And what I've done once I've sampled the sample in here, it's basically sampled raw, wholesale, lock, stock, and barrel. The only thing that I've lost is the filter modulation that I've had on the EPS Classic. I can't get that by sampling. It's basically I got the one take of the sample in. So once it's in here, what I've done was basically use the ASR-10 to create space and create more character. So essentially all I'm doing here is I'm using the ASR-10's filters and the LFO to create a lot of pop and a lot of movement on two planes. One is like you'll hear initial bursts of filters, and that's coming from the LFO. And then I've used the global filter over everything to have it just ride in. So you'll hear the audio swell and do certain things as the sample progresses. On top of that, I've layered the sample with itself and added some more movement on that layer. Also, I've added effects. So let's just listen to what we have here. right? So that's pretty much what I ended up with. And essentially, in this kind of procedure, I'm really using these samplers, like the process you just saw of bouncing from sampler to sampler, is really for power. Like, yes, character helps. It definitely does. But I'm using the samplers for the sheer power that they have. So the things that I can do on the ASR-10 cannot be done as well on the EPS as far as effects and just using the ASR-10 to smooth things out and give it a whole lot of space. Really, the EPS isn't that great for that just because its character is so prominent. And the things that I can do on the EPS definitely can't do on the S950. And on modular, well, that's a synth and the control is also limited there. So I basically just messed around and kind of gotten to where I've gotten here. And this isn't something I wouldn't do like in regular practice, but today I have time to play around and experiment. And I would say, like, if you're trying to just kick around with your sounds, this is the way to learn. Like, you'll definitely come across stuff that you haven't done before just because it's a different goal that you have in mind. It's more just like play around just to play around. Anyway, that's all I wanted to show. In the meantime, please do take care of yourself. I'll catch you on the next one. Peace.